The following is distributed by the Berean Call.
The next speaker, as I mentioned in the introduction, he's taking the place of Warren Smith, who had technical problems and so on. But the man I'm introducing here needs no introduction for those Bereans, those who have been part of the ministry for years. And even for those who haven't, I had the privilege of working with Dave on a book called The Seduction of Christianity. That book, most people, well, I don't know today because it was written 30 some years ago, but that book really had an impact on the church. So Dave is home with the Lord now, but we have found, to replace Warren, we have found a couple of videos that we think are absolutely appropriate and not viewed by many. These were produced in South Africa, and the title of one is Deception in the Church. Where is it taking us? That you'll see how it lines up with the other speakers. And then A Cult Invasion of the Church. I've had the privilege of working with Dave for 40 years, and I've learned so much from the man. And I believe, it's my personal opinion, he was ahead of the curve. He was a guy who understood what was coming into the church, and it's taken years for the church to kind of catch up with some of that. Not everybody, but for the most part. So we're thrilled to be able to show you these videos online, and I think it's going to be a blessing.
We talked about deception in the church, and there's a lot of deception. We didn't have time to go into all of it. We may talk about a little bit more this evening, but I thought this evening we should consider where is this taking us? What is going on? Sometimes I puzzle about it. On the other hand, the scripture tells us. In fact, the scripture says, when you see these things come to pass, rejoice. Your redemption draweth nigh. And we noted that Jesus foretold these days. Paul tells us in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, he uses the same terminology. Remember, Jesus said the very first thing he said when they asked him, when will these things be? What will be the sign of your coming? And so forth. He said, beware that no man deceive you. And many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and so forth. And Paul uses the same language in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. He says, don't let anyone deceive you. That day, the day of the Lord, which the scripture tells us, I wish we could go in discuss the day of the Lord, but again, we don't have time for that. But the day of the Lord comes as a thief in the night, remember? Paul talks about it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. He said, you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them. I believe that the rapture marks the beginning of the day of the Lord, and perhaps we can talk about how close do we think that might be. We should be expecting the rapture at any moment. But he says, don't let anyone deceive you. That day will not come except the falling away comes first, the apostasy comes first. So this is obviously where we're heading. And in fact, it's where we have to go. Isn't that right? You can't come to the day of the Lord except the apostasy comes. So we shouldn't be, on the one hand, we mourn, and Paul wept, as we noted this morning. On the other hand, this is what we are to expect from Scripture. Now, I believe in imminency. I believe the rapture could occur at any moment. I believe it always could have occurred at any moment after the death of the apostles. So you say, well then, we've done away with imminency if the apostasy has to come first. No, the apostasy has been here from the beginning. Paul said, all they in Asia have forsaken me. Most of the scriptures, the New Testament scriptures, were written to correct error that was already in the church. Were they not? And Paul, as we quoted this morning, he said, after mighty parting, grievous wolves will enter in. Of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. So I guess the question is, how bad does it have to get? I don't find any scripture that says it has to get so bad. I've been talking about this, writing about it for 25 years, and I can only say it has gotten worse than I thought. I could not have imagined how bad it is now. Well, let's consider some of the characteristics of this, and again, I'm just always tempted to quote the scriptures, but we could turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4. You know the scripture well. 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly. That's the Holy Spirit. So pay attention to this. This is an express declaration from the Holy Spirit. In the latter times, we're going to have this great revival, and you'll read about it in the Christian magazines, and you'll Charisma, and you'll see it on television, and Paul and Jan Crouch on TBN will be telling you about it. It's not what it says. In the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. I wish we had time to discuss that in more detail. You remember when King Jehoshaphat, who was a good king, he made a partnership with Ahab, who sold himself to do wickedness, and there was none like Ahab, the most wicked king that Israel knew. And here's one of the most godly kings, and he joins in a partnership with Ahab. Very similar to what we see today. We see at least people that I had confidence in as leading evangelicals, and they're joining in partnership with people who are not sound in doctrine, who preach a false gospel, and then it begins to influence them. And you remember, the Lord held a council. Well, there was this prophet Micaiah, you remember? I really admire Micaiah. It's rather amazing what Micaiah knew. Well, he was a true prophet of God. And you remember Jehoshaphat said, well, before we go out to war, they joined for war because they had a common enemy. That's another thing that brings these people together in a coalition. Well, we've got a common enemy. We're going to fight abortion together. We're going to fight homosexuality. We're going to fight child abuse and so forth. So let's get together. They had a common enemy, but Jehoshaphat said, I think we should consult the Lord. Do you have any prophets? And Ahab brings 400 prophets. And they all are in agreement One of them puts iron horns on his, you know, and says, "Thus shalt thou, you know, destroy the king of Assyria," and everybody's predicting prosperity and blessing. And it's just kind of a little bit too unanimous for Jehoshaphat. He says, "Isn't there another prophet?" And Ahab says, "Yeah, there's one more, but he never prophesies good for me." He's one of these negative guys, you know. Micaiah, "Well," Jehoshaphat says, "don't feel that way about it. Call him." And the man that goes to call him says, "Now look, we're all in agreement. Don't rock the boat. We have already prophesied blessing and victory." Jehoshaphat says, I'm sorry, Micaiah says, "I will say what the Lord tells me to say." And he stands before the king, and you know the story. At first, he's making fun. He says, "Oh yes, great victory, you know." So, and obviously, you know that he's not serious about that. And then he says, "The Lord had a council. And he said, how shall I entice Ahab to go out and to be killed in battle to fulfill the prophecy of Elijah?" And you know the prophecy of Elijah. The dogs would lick his blood, where they licked the blood of Naboth and so forth. And one spirit said this, another spirit said that, and finally a spirit stood before the Lord. This is Micaiah now telling what happened in heaven. And he said, "I will be a lying spirit in the mouths of all of his prophets." And God said, "Go, you will accomplish it." And Micaiah looks at the prophets, and he looks at Ahab, and he says, "God has put a lying spirit in the mouths of all of these your prophets." Whoa. Well, put him in irons, you know, and give him bread and water to eat and so forth, until I return in peace. And Micaiah yells to all the people that are watching, "If he returns in peace, I'm a false prophet. He will not return in peace." And of course, he did not. He was killed. Now that's rather an amazing story. Go back and study it. It's fascinating. One spirit made 400 prophets lie. That's staggering. "I will be a lying spirit in the mouth of all of his prophets." And then if you went to 1 John chapter 4, it says, "Don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits, for many false prophets have gone out into the world." So you know that there is a lying spirit behind false prophets. Lying for what? Just to get them to lie? No, no. There is a purpose in their lying. And so now Paul says, "The Spirit, that is the Holy Spirit, speaketh expressly in the latter times, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." Devils have doctrines. Doctrine is very, very important. The truth of God, doctrine, is the container of the truth of God, of the gospel. And it defines it and explains it so we can understand it. And Satan's lie opposes the truth. And Satan's lies do not vary. And he has doctrine. And there we have people today who are giving heed to seducing spirits. Now, this is nothing new. Eve was the first one who gave heed to a seducing spirit, right? And the seducing spirit happened to be Satan himself speaking through a serpent. This has been the way of indigenous religions down through history from the beginning. We mentioned a little bit about that this morning. This is a book that you may or may not know, Ubuntu. You see this word in the newspapers here in South Africa. It's written by Lovemore Mabigi. I guess that's how you pronounce it. By the way, an interesting man. He earns several million rand a month advising major corporations and how to solve their labor problems and how to be successful and so forth. He was supposedly a Christian and was sent by a Christian church who supported him while he went to the United States to gain a theological education. And listen to what he teaches. He says, the concept of reincarnation is central to our religion. The author personally believes in it and in the hierarchy of African ancestral spirits. You know, it's very difficult when some of the indigenous peoples supposedly come to Christ. They keep going back to their ancestral spirits. Very, very difficult to break them loose from that. He says, we believe in one God. That God lives in all natural things. In the earth, the sky, the rain, the cave, the mountains, and in all growing things such as trees and animals. The spirit lives everywhere. It's customary in most African tribes to let a spirit inhabit a particular canonized sacred tree if a suitable human medium cannot be found. And then he goes on, he says, there's common practice to dedicate a particular sacred place for a particular spirit to inhabit. This could be a special cave or a mountain or river pool. Could be a special ritual hut. A spirit can also inhabit an animal. And it goes on, says it's common practice to cast out an evil spirit by projecting it onto a black hen and a black goat. And then there are guardian spirits that he speaks of. The belief in God and the spirit. God is revered, and one should not speak to him directly except through the spirits and ancestors. And he goes on and talks about a man is possessed by the spirit. He talks about some of the ceremonies and so forth. And then he says this, there is very little difference between Christianity and our Afrocentric religion. This is a man who was schooled in theology in the United States. And he says that the only hope for Africa is to get back to the ancestral religions and for modern corporations to tap in to this pool of spiritual power. Shamanism has been practiced around the world, and this is one of my books, Occult Invasion. You would find it more or less a handbook on some of these things that are happening. Shamanism is the same everywhere on the face of this earth. And I won't go into shamanism, but it is being revived in the West. And this is a letter, we receive thousands of letters. This particular person is a nurse, and she writes, dear Brother Dave and so forth, a recent guest lecturer who comes to the hospital, who had survived breast cancer, kept our class enthralled for 2 hours with the explanation for her remarkable recovery. Meditation, visualization, positive self-talk to her inner child, mantras, psychotherapy, and tapping into the energy of the universe. God was given credit for existing as whatever we perceive that to be. Now, this is a major psychology magazine from the United States. This is an article about Alfred Altshuler, Dr. Altshuler. He's the president of the John F. Kennedy University in California. And The title of the article is Altshuler Entreats Counselors, that is psychological counselors, to learn about inner voices. He says we need to get in touch with these beings that are trying to communicate with us. This idea of spirit communication is very popular in the business world, in medicine, and in education, and so forth. Paganism entered the church through Constantine, the emperor. Constantine conquered Rome in 313 AD. He supposedly became a Christian. Remember, he heard a voice. Well, he saw a sign, a cross in the sky, but it wasn't the cross that you would have on the top of your church here. It was a Mithraic cross honoring the god Mithras. And so it was very ecumenical. He had a lot of followers of the god Mithras in his army. But anyway, he heard a voice that said, "In this sign thou shalt conquer." And supposedly he became a Christian. But let me quote a Roman Catholic historian, a Catholic priest, Philip Hughes. "In his manners, Constantine remained to the end the pagan of his early life. His furious tempers, the cruelty which spared not the lives even of his wife and son, are an unpleasing witness to the imperfection of his conversion." Constantine continued to preside over the pagan priesthood, as the emperor. He was worshipped as God. The emperor was the head of the pagan priesthood there in Rome, which was called the Pontifical College. As you know, the Pontifical College exists in Rome today. It is now headed by the Pope. As the emperor, he was the head of the religion of the empire, which was polytheism, So when he gave freedom to Christianity and he promoted the Christian church, basically for political reasons, he was smart enough to realize, what's the point of killing these Christians? They don't get drunk, they don't rebel, they don't start revolutions, they're hard workers. Why don't we encourage them? Maybe some of that will rub off on the rest of society. So he gave freedom to the Christian churches who had been so persecuted. And as the emperor, he became the de facto head of the Christian church. And he called, if you want to study ecumenism, you want to study Constantine. He was the first ecumenist. He called the first ecumenical council, the Council of Nicaea. He decided who would be there, the subject they would discuss. He gave the opening address, and so forth. And so as the de facto head of the Christian church, Constantine took the title Vicarius Christi in Latin. Now, Vicarius Christi, Vicarius happens to be the Latin equivalent of the Greek anti. So, Vicar of Christ, Vicarius Christi, literally means anti-Christ. But he didn't mean he was against Christ. Anti, the Greek prefix, also means in the place of. Not only against, but in the place of, or a substitute for. He was in the place of Christ. Well, you know who bears the title Vicarius Christi today? Vicar of Christ, the popes. All the titles that the popes have, they picked up from Constantine. And that was documented it was a document called the Donation of Constantine. It was a fraud. Even Catholic historians today acknowledge that this was a counterfeit. It was a fraud. But the popes used it in the Middle Ages to justify the power that they had taken. And they said that Constantine had given them their robes and their paraphernalia and his palace and so forth and so on. But the point I'm trying to make is, when Constantine supposedly became a Christian and he gave freedom to the Christian church, paganism took over. And paganism, in fact, survived under Christian terminology. Let me quote Will Durant. He's, I think, leading historian in history in the world. Will Durant writes, he's not a Christian, he doesn't have an axe to grind, he's just a historian. He says, paganism survived within the church in the form of ancient rites and customs condoned or accepted and transformed by an often indulgent church. Statues of Isis and Horus were renamed Mary and Jesus. In fact, Pope Leo I boasted that St. Peter and St. Paul had replaced Romulus and Remus as Rome's protecting patrons. He goes on, he says, the Roman Lupercalion, the Feast of Purification of Isis, became the Feast of the Nativity. Pastor indicated some of this morning. The Saturnalia were replaced by Christmas celebration, an ancient festival of the dead by All Souls Day, rededicated to Christian heroes. Incense, lights, processions, vestments, and so forth were cleansed, and paganism was brought into the church. Soon, people and priests would use the sign of the cross as a magic incantation to expel or drive away demons. And then, listen to this. This is what the historian says. Paganism passed like maternal blood into the new religion, and captive Rome captured her conqueror. Christianity supposedly conquered. No, paganism conquered. And paganism took over the church, but under the cover of a thin veneer of Christian terminology. Well, what about what we've just been quoting about the, you know, the native religions and so forth? Are they still embraced today? Yes. If you went to Haiti today, they have a saying in Haiti that Haiti is 85% Roman Catholic and 110% Voodoo. Every voodoo ceremony begins with prayers to Catholic saints. In fact, all the voodoo gods are Catholic, well, they named them after Catholic saints. They brought this religion from Africa, the slaves who were taken to the New World, and in order to hide their witchcraft, they named their gods after Catholic saints. And today, there is an incredible mixture of Catholicism and voodoo. I'm quoting from our Sunday Visitor. Now, that's a major Catholic newspaper. And the article was titled, In the Temple of the Voodoo. And it asked this question, quote, why is New Orleans, one of the world's most Catholic cities, caught in the bewitching spell of an ancient cult? And it goes on, it talks about how Catholics are practicing voodoo as well as going to the Mass. And that this thing has become so intertwined is talking about, Ava Priestess, she's a voodoo priestess. She's graduated from a Catholic high school, from Loyola University School of Law, a Catholic university, and she has foregone a career in law to devote her life to voodoo. She lectures frequently on voodoo and African religions to such diverse groups as the American College of Surgeons, the American Academy of Cardiology. So the world is open to this, just exactly as Ubuntu and Lovemore Mabigi says it ought to be. And then it says, a call to her will often be met with, I'm with a client now, can I call you back? You can get that on her voice message. And she will, as soon as she returns from daily Mass and communion. So, voodoo priestess. Well, the Pope, you remember Pope John Paul II, I'm quoting now from a newspaper report. Pope John Paul II sought common ground with believers in voodoo Thursday, suggesting they would not betray their traditional faith by converting to Christianity. Do you remember? I quoted this man, and what did he say? There is very little difference between Christianity and our Afrocentric religion. And I heard gasps from you. Well, listen to the Pope. He suggested that voodoo priests would not betray their traditional faith by converting to Christianity. On the second day of his 10th African pilgrimage, the Pope held a dramatic and emotional meeting with the priests of the Vodun. The Pope told the Voodooists that just as they draw on their ancestors for their religion, so do Christians revere their ancestors. Voodoo priests at the meeting, I'm quoting from the newspaper, warmly welcomed the pontiff. Well, something is going on. There is an apostasy. It's been with us for a long time. You can trace it back to Roman Catholicism. It involves ancestor worship, prayers. If you went to Rio de Janeiro, for example, go into a cemetery, I got a little Freudian slip there. If you went into a cemetery on a Catholic holiday in Rio de Janeiro, you would see the Roman Catholics on their knees by the graveside praying to their ancestors and to the so-called saints. And indeed, prayers to the saints, is that not communion with the dead? Which is absolutely forbidden in the Bible. Now, along with this, we have apparitions of Mary. Apparitions around the world. You would be familiar with some of the major apparition sites. You have Our Lady of this, Our Lady of that, Our Lady of Fatima in Portugal, Our Lady of Lourdes in France. In fact, in France, my last count, there are about 950 apparitions. I mean, sites of apparitions. And hundreds of millions of pilgrims visit them each year. I've only been able to locate in the world two places in the world that honor Jesus. But you have hundreds and hundreds, well, thousands of sites honoring Mary. The Pope, you remember, he was moving through the crowd and he saw a little girl who had a pendant with a picture of Our Lady of Fatima around her neck, and he bent over to bless her, and pew, pew, the first two bullets from the would-be assassin went right where his head had been. The assassin, would-be assassin, got him in his body. And the Pope said that he felt the protection of Our Lady of Fatima, her protecting presence, that she was the one who delivered him. He said that she appeared to him during his convalescence, and she gave him, she told him that she had saved his life because she had a mission for him to accomplish, and she would cause the whole world to bow to his supreme authority. Now, we've got some amazing apparitions of Mary. Now, this one was an apparition of Mary. Well, it appeared on a bank building in Clearwater, Florida. And people, Catholics by the thousands, came to worship there. But you've had some amazing apparitions of Mary. Let me just give you a couple of them. Well, I'll give you one here. This occurred in a suburb of Cairo, Egypt. It was witnessed by at least a million Egyptians. Mary appeared on a rooftop of a church. It was so steep, the people were frightened. She was in a white robe, white dress, and they were yelling, "Don't jump, don't jump." They thought this was a woman up there about to commit suicide. A rescue team was summoned. And the newspaper Watani reported, quote, "They all saw her dressed as if in a bright gown of light in a view similar to that associated with the Virgin Mary. The apparition returned a week later and soon was seen up to three times a week, on occasion visible for hours. Huge crowds formed around the church. At times, the crowd swelled to an estimated 250,000 people at once watching this apparition. And for the first time in Egyptian history, Catholics, Orthodox, and Muslims prayed together in public." the Muslims chant it from the Quran because the Quran honors Mary. In fact, Fulton Sheen, Archbishop Fulton Sheen from the United States, he wrote a book in which he said that the conversion of the Muslims would not happen by ordinary means, you know, that Christians would expect, but it would be through Our Lady of Fatima. And wasn't it amazing that when Our Lady appeared there in this little village in Portugal, she chose to appear in Fatima, which the Muslims, when they were in possession of this part of the world, they named it Fatima after Muhammad's favorite daughter. And Muhammad said, O Fatima, thou art the most highly honored of all the women in heaven after Our Lady the Virgin. And so he said that the Quran, Muhammad, they highly honor the Virgin Mary, and that it would be through her, specifically Our Lady of Fatima, that Muslims would be brought into the church. And if you take an image of Our Lady, well, there's only one image that's there at Fatima, and we've been there. You take that image of Our Lady of Fatima. I was trying to think of shrine. That was the word I was trying to think of. Only two shrines for Jesus, thousands of them for Mary. You take that image of Our Lady of Fatima through Muslim territory in Indonesia, in India, and other places. The Muslims come out by the hundreds of thousands to honor her. Well, so here we have Catholics, Orthodox, Muslims praying together in public. And the Muslims chanted from the Quran, Mary, God has chosen thee and purified thee. He has chosen thee above all women. Some amazing apparitions of Mary that have taken place around the world. Now, the Pope, John Paul II, when he was in Mexico, I'm quoting, listen to what he said. All those who have at some time prayed to the Most Holy Virgin, even though they may have strayed from the Catholic Church, conserve in their hearts an ember of faith which can be revived. The Virgin awaits them with maternal arms open wide. If you've prayed to the Virgin, you've got an ember of faith in your heart that is going to draw you back into the embrace of the church, and the Virgin awaits you with arms open wide. Now, what are these? What are these apparitions? What do they signify? Well, I remember I was at Fatima in Portugal, and there was a priest sitting on the steps of the cathedral there, and he was reading a black book, and my guide said, oh, he's reading the Bible. I said, you got to be kidding. A Catholic priest is not reading the Bible. He's reading his breviary, which turned out to be true, and he turned out to be from England, and so I didn't need my interpreter, and I talked to him. I walked up to him, and I said, you know, I'm so fascinated to be here at Fatima. And I've visited some of the apparition sites. But you know, there's one thing that really puzzles me. Because when Our Lady of Fatima appeared, she said, many souls perish and go to hell because there's no one to make sacrifice for them. And I said, you know, I thought that Christ had made the sacrifice. So what was she talking about? Well, he said, that's going to take a little time to explain. We've got to go outside. I didn't know what he meant by that, but you can't smoke on the grounds. So we went outside, and he was smoking one cigarette after another. We're sitting on a wall, and I thought lightning would strike when he said, you know, it's like this. You know, a ship can bring the cargo into port, but it takes somebody else to unload it and deliver it. And Christ brought the cargo into port. But you see, I'm quoting him verbatim, he's not so much the Savior you thought he was, is he? Well, Our Lady of Fatima says, and let me give you a quote, "I promise," and by the way, she has been honored by every pope since her appearance. She said, "I promise to assist at the hour of death with the graces necessary for salvation all those who on the first Saturday of 5 consecutive months shall confess, receive Holy Communion, recite 5 decades of the Rosary, and keep me company for 15 minutes while meditating on the 15 mysteries of the Rosary with the intention of making reparation to me for the sins committed against my Immaculate Heart, and die wearing my brown scapular." That's Doctrines of Devils. And if there's any Catholics here tonight, I don't want to offend you. That is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the works gospel. She says, "I promise to assist at the hour of death with all the graces necessary for salvation." I don't need her graces. And she doesn't, well, in the Rosary, she's called the Mother of Mercy. I don't need her mercy. I don't need her grace, because it is Christ who died on the cross and paid the penalty for my sins. So now we have these apparitions that are teaching doctrines of devils. And then along with Our Lady of Fatima comes a little Jesus, about so high, about 2 years old, floating on a cloud of light. And he says, "There will never be peace in this world until this world is dedicated to the Immaculate Heart of my Mother Mary in reparation for the sins committed against her." That's a little devil impersonating Jesus. That's not the gospel of Jesus Christ. Mary comes with her peace plan, and she says, "How long can I hold back my son's hand from pouring out his wrath upon this earth?" She says she's the one who will bring peace. No, the Bible says Jesus Christ made peace through the blood of his cross. Amen. And that there will never be peace on this earth until the Prince of Peace reigns. So now we have people giving heed to seducing spirits, offering doctrines of devils. This is Oral Roberts again, and here's his handprint, or the outline of his hand. "Touch my hand and believe with me for your miracle, answer from heaven. Do it every day and pray. Prepare your heart for July 28th. That's July 28th, that's the magic day when God is going to move in power. And then he says, "This is our point of contact." Have you heard that phrase? We hear it a lot in America. I don't know if you hear it over here. What do they mean by point of contact? You know, reach out and touch my hand on the television screen, and that will be our point of contact. They get that from Matthew 18, where it says, "If two of you shall agree as touching anything, it shall be done of your Father which is in heaven." Well, that's the Old English. It means, as touching means concerning, regarding. If two of you shall agree regarding something. But they think that means you got to touch something. And so now we're going to touch things, and that's going to bring the miracles from God. And people believe this, and they're being led astray. They're being deceived. That's a witchcraft technique. This comes from seducing spirits. It's a doctrine of devils. And some of these witchcraft techniques that are now coming into the church are very, very similar to what we have in the occult. We have the Shakti pad. You know what a Shakti pad is? Shakti is Durga, Kali. You've heard of Kali. She got 6 arms. She got freshly cut hands and skulls. She's drinking blood out of a skull and so forth. And the Hindu says her beauty is in her terror. And she has her heel on the chest or the neck of Shiva, her husband, the great god, and so forth. She's the Star Wars force. Shakti means force. in the Sanskrit. A shakti pat is a force touch. The guru touches your forehead and you are gone. You are down. You have spiritual experiences. We see this on television. Christians, professing Christians, are doing this. And I thought you might find it of interest. Let me read the testimony of some of these gurus. This is Swami Muktananda. He received the Shakti Pat from his guru Nityananda, known as Guru Dev, worshipped as God. And this is how he describes the awakening of the Kundalini power. And the Kundalini is the serpent goddess coiled at the base of the spine. He says, this is a Hindu guru now, Shaktipat is simply another name for the full grace of the Supreme Guru. Sometimes my body would writhe and twist like a snake's, while a hissing sound would come from inside me. Sometimes my neck moved so violently that it made loud cracking sounds. It would roll my head so vigorously. You know, have you seen, if you watched the videos of the Brownsville Assembly of God revival, so-called, or the Toronto Blessing, you will see the very thing that he's talking about. He says, my identification with a lion had become stronger still. I roared so much that the cows nearly broke their ropes. Dogs barked madly. People rushed to my hut. Sometimes I would jump and hop like a frog. Sometimes roar like a tiger. People, here's someone talking about him now, this power that he received. You remember, Benny Hinn says he goes to the graves of Catherine Kuhlman and Amy Semple McPherson. And that is where the Holy Ghost is lingering, and that's where he picks up the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Now, someone is describing the power of this man. Quote, people vibrated in his energy field as he threw out waves of power into the audience, thunderbolts of Shaktipat, and people are falling. I remember watching Benny Hinn on Trinity Broadcasting Network. I think you could get that off of satellite. I don't know how many of you do, but anyway, they have the largest television network in the world. And here they are sitting there, Paul and Jan Crouch, Benny Hinn, and Benny is telling how he touched a man and he fell over backward and his wig flew off and he puts it on a bit askew and he gets up and five times, Benny says, I touched him, made him fall down just to see the wig fall off. And he's laughing, Paul and Jan Crouch are laughing. That is not the power of God. The Holy Spirit does not knock people down to make their wigs fall off, okay? But what is going on? There is some kind of a power. As he swings his jacket and the whole choir falls over. This is not the power of God. I don't read anything like that in the Bible. I don't read that that happened when Jesus preached the word, when he healed people. I don't read that it happened in the book of Acts. But this is an occult manifestation. They've been giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And now horrific manifestations have come into the church, which unfortunately people think are a sign of revival. And they say, we're following the revival. I want to go to Brownsville to see the revival. Why do you think there's revival there? Oh, because of the powerful truth of the Word of God that is... No. Because of the manifestations that are there. And so they somehow equate these manifestations with revival. Then it brings deception and delusion, false prophecies. Kenneth Copeland is preaching to a large audience near Dallas, Texas, and he says, suddenly Jesus began to talk through him. And Jesus said, don't be upset when people accuse you of claiming to be God. They accuse me of that. Wouldn't they accuse you? And then this Jesus says, but I never claimed to be God. I just claimed to be a man through whom God worked. So we have a denial of the deity of Jesus Christ from a so-called Jesus speaking through a so-called prophet. I think there were about 10,000 people present on that occasion. Not one stood up and said, "Heresy! Heresy! That's a denial of the deity of Jesus Christ." But the same people that deny the deity of Jesus Christ, they take that deity to themselves. And so Kenneth Copeland says, "You don't have a God living in you. You are one." This is Kenneth Copeland. This is in writing. September 1991, Believer's Voice of Victory. You would think the editor would catch it. You would think somebody would find fault. But I don't know how many hundreds of thousands of people read this. He says, when Christ died upon the cross, even though he said it is finished, it wasn't finished. Even though he said, "Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit," he didn't end up in the hands of the Father, he ended up in the hands of hell, of Satan in hell. Even though he said to the thief crucified beside him, "This day you will be with me in paradise," he didn't go to paradise, he went to hell. Listen, I'm quoting him now. "The day that Jesus was crucified, God's life, that eternal energy, moved out of him, and he allowed the devil to drag him into the depths of hell as if he were the most wicked sinner who ever lived, and to come under Satan's control. For 3 days, every demon in hell came down on him to annihilate him, tortured him beyond anything that has ever been conceived. In a thunder of spiritual force, the voice of God spoke to the death-whipped, broken, punished spirit of Jesus. God's word changed the spirit of Jesus with resurrection power. Suddenly, his twisted, death-racked spirit began to fill out and come back to life. He was literally being reborn before the devil's very eyes. Before his body even had time to decay. David writes in the Psalms, "Thou wilt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption." It wasn't a matter of time. It was impossible for his body to decay. I remember a dear young mother in England. She was being martyred because she would not believe in transubstantiation. And as they set fire to burn her at the stake, she said, "I know that wafer is not the body of Jesus, because the scripture said that thou wilt not suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. And you let that wafer sit around for a week or two, it will breed worms. It will breed mold. It will corrupt. And that is not the body of Jesus." But anyway, it says, "Before his body even had time to decay, Jesus Christ dragged Satan up and down the halls of hell. The day I realized that a born-again man had defeated Satan, hell, and death, I got so excited." So our redemption doesn't come through the blood of Jesus Christ shed upon the cross, although the Bible says, Ephesians 1:7, Colossians 1:14, "In whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins." It didn't come through his sacrifice upon the cross, it comes through Satan torturing Jesus. So if Satan didn't torture Jesus enough, we're not saved. If he tortured him enough, then I guess he's our co-redeemer, and we should thank him. This is such horrible heresy. This is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. But this is what comes forth then when they begin to give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. If you went to Acts 8, and we don't have time to turn to it, remember Simon the magician. He came to Peter, and he said, "Peter, give me this power," because Peter laid his hands upon them. They had received the Holy Spirit. And Simon the magician said, "Teach me how to do this, and I will pay you." And Peter said, "Your money perish with you." Well, John Wimber, he's thought to be the founder of the Vineyard Movement. John Wimber went around the world teaching signs and wonders seminars and charging for it. My wife and I were just leaving Sydney, Australia, when Wimber and his team arrived. They had 5,500 pastors and church leaders there. They charged them $150 each. And they taught them how to do miracles. You don't learn how to do miracles. A miracle is a manifestation of the Holy Spirit. And it's not something that you can learn and now you've got a handle on it and you can make it happen. This is occultism. The occultist passes down, you know, the formula and the way to make this work from father to son, from mother to daughter, and so forth. Peter kept occultism out of the early church. But occultism came into the early church through Constantine. And it is here with us today. Let me give you just a couple of quotes from John Wimber so you understand. Well, when Chuck Smith is, I don't know if you've even heard of the Calvary Chapel movement. There's several hundred Calvary Chapels, probably 800 or 900 Calvary Chapels around the world now. The tremendous movement that began with the Jesus movement, and you would find hippies there in those days and drug addicts and getting saved and so forth. And John Wimber actually had a very large Calvary Chapel. And Chuck Smith, the founder of the Calvary Chapel movement, became concerned about what was happening. If you watch the videos from those days in John Wimber's vineyard, they're just the same as you would see from Toronto or Pensacola today. And so they had a gathering of a number of pastors, and Chuck Smith was confronting John Wimber and asking him about these manifestations. And finally, this is what it came down to. Chuck Smith said, John, are you going to go by experience or by the Bible? John Wimber said, we're going to go by experience. If it works, that's what we're going to do. Now, John Wimber said, quote, we are cataloging all of our experiences so we can develop a theology. That's an astonishing statement. He says theology doesn't come from the Bible, but it comes from experience. He said critical thinking must be laid aside. It is nothing less than dangerous. It's dangerous for you to think. Rodney Howard Brown puts you out of the meeting if you look like you're thinking and questioning him. So you can see where this comes from. Their teaching, by their own admission, does not come from the Bible. It comes from their experience. But we've got to go by the Bible. The Bible has to be my authority. And you better check your experiences out against the Word of God. But John Wimber was the mentor of C. Peter Wagner, one of the leaders in the so-called spiritual warfare movement around the world. They go on prayer marches. They claim territory. Youth with a Mission has sent teams to the northernmost, southernmost, easternmost, westernmost point on every continent on this earth to do strategic spiritual level warfare praying, as though your prayer would have some special power if you prayed from a particular place. And C. Peter Wagner, one of the leaders in this, listen to what he says. He's introducing a book. He says, this book uncovers the wiles of the devil and exposes the prayer targets that will force the enemy to release millions of unsaved souls now held captive. I am excited that God has given us a marvelous new tool for effective spiritual warfare. So here's a new tool that Paul didn't know about, Peter didn't know about, the apostles didn't know about. Wesley, Whitfield, Spurgeon, you name them. Andrew Murray, he didn't know about it. But now we have discovered. How did we discover it? Did we get it from the Word of God? No, we did not get it from the Word of God. They got it from seducing spirits. And these are doctrines of devils, but they say we have new techniques now that will release millions of souls to be saved. Can you imagine that somehow God has kept millions of souls in bondage down through the centuries by holding back the revelation of the technique that would release them? Doesn't make sense, does it? Listen to what he says. One fundamental thesis will control this discussion of us coming to grips with some of the relatively new and at times somewhat radical ideas surrounding strategic levels, spiritual warfare, spiritual mapping. I don't know whether you would all be familiar with that term, but you have to map out Cape Town, folks. My wife and I were in Chile, Santiago, Chile, and there was a charismatic leader while we were there. He was in an airplane circling around Santiago, and he was radioing down to them what demonic spirits were in charge of this territory, and that territory, and that territory. You've got to mark it all out, and then you have to pray specifically against these demonic spirits. Well, I mean, isn't that biblical? Before Paul went to Ephesus, didn't he send Timothy ahead to map it out and bind the territorial spirits? And so that's not true. It's nonsense. But what it does is it diverts people off into the area of the occult. Well, spiritual mapping, identificational repentance. I've got to go back and I've got to confess all the sins of my ancestors. I don't even know the sins of my ancestors. I mean, my father was from Hull, England. Probably some of my ancestors were Druids, you know, at Stonehenge. But I don't know. I don't know all the sins of my ancestors. But they'll tell you, well, then how are you going to do this? Well, you got to make like Freud introduced and like Christian psychologists practice. You've got to go back. You've got to somehow visualize and find out all of these things that happened back there. You know what that does? This is called inner healing. And some of these dear women is practiced rampantly in the United States. They go back and they uncover some trauma and they visualize Jesus coming along to heal this. And, they feel so much better and so much closer to the Lord. It doesn't last too long. The problem is there's another experience. There's something else back there. And I'm going to have to go back and probe deeper. So it puts you on an endless search. And it is not biblical. But here's what I wanted to get to. One fundamental thesis will control this discussion. The thesis that ministry, that is experience, precedes and produces theology, not the reverse. So this thing is going to be by what we experience, and that's what we're going to trust. Not the Word of God, but what does Isaiah 8:20 say? To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, there is no light in them. Well, these people are being led astray. It's a tragedy. We have the Alpha Course. I think some of you may know about the Alpha Course. It's becoming very, very popular. What's wrong? What could be wrong with the Alpha Course? Well, first of all, the Alpha Course comes from the Vineyards. It comes from Toronto. It comes out of Holy Trinity, Brompton, England. And that was the center for the Laughing Revival. And it came from Toronto. And John Wimber, well, Nicky Gumbel, who is the man who narrates this course, he's the inventor of the course. He backs Rodney Howard Brown to the hilt. That would give you some idea of his spiritual discernment. He tells how the Toronto experience came to Holy Trinity Brompton. I'm quoting him. He says, a group of leaders were meeting, and Ellie Mumford told us a little bit of what she had seen in Toronto. It was obvious that Ellie was just dying to pray for all of us. Then she said, now we'll invite the Holy Spirit to come. That's a common expression in these meetings. What do you mean you're going to invite the Holy Spirit to come? If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Romans chapter 8. Every believer is indwelt by the Holy Spirit. And Jesus Christ said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And I don't have to invite Jesus to come, and I don't call upon the Holy Spirit to come. But anyway, she invited the Holy Spirit to come. And the moment she said that, one of the people was thrown literally across the room and was lying on the floor, just howling and laughing, making the most incredible noise. I experienced the power of the Spirit in a way I hadn't experienced for years, like massive electricity going through my body. One of the guys was prophesying. He was just lying there prophesying. One of them started laughing like a hyena, and so forth. I mean, isn't it marvelous? Isn't it wonderful what God was doing? No, this is not God doing it. You remember Benny Hinn, when he saw Catherine Kuhlman, he said, I wanted that power with every fiber of my being. It's all about power, getting power. And Nicky Gumbel, on another occasion, he tells how John Wimber prayed for him. And there he felt like 10,000 volts went through him. And he said, the American, John Wimber, all he ever prayed was power, more power, more power. And he got power. But it's not the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the origin of the Alpha Course. The Alpha Course, or he's the originator of the Alpha Course, the Alpha Course does not give you the gospel. Catholics love the Alpha Course. The Alpha Course is being taught in a lot of Roman Catholic churches. It's very ecumenical. The emphasis is upon miracles and healing and prophecy. You don't get saved. You don't hear the gospel. And the big event, big night comes Saturday night if you do the weekend course, when the Holy Spirit comes. That's the decisive moment. And you get this power. Well, they get a power. Unsaved people get a power. But it's not the power of God. It's a tragedy. This is deceiving so many people in so many churches today. Now, something else that came from the vineyard. I'm talking about John Wimber now. Something else that came from the vineyard is Promise Keepers. Promise Keepers works very closely, as I mentioned, with the Roman Catholic Church. Bill McCartney, the founder of Promise Keepers, says that it was his intention that full participation by Roman Catholics, that was intended from the very beginning. Promise Keepers changed their statement of faith to satisfy the Roman Catholics. Promise Keepers has a Roman Catholic on its board. Promise Keepers uses a Roman Catholic evangelist. By the way, the same man who's Catholic who's on the board of Promise Keepers is the new head of Prison Fellowship, Charles Colson's Prison Fellowship. And by his own admission, Charles Colson says 80% of their counselors that go into the prisons are Roman Catholics. Well, maybe some of you don't know what could be wrong with that. We explained a little bit about it last night. Let me just as quickly as I can explain it again, because it's very important. You have about 1 billion Roman Catholics. Some of you know them. You say, but I have a Catholic friend or a Catholic neighbor, and he or she says they believe Christ died for their sins. They believe Jesus is God, eternally co-equal with the Father, that he came into this world born of a virgin, of the Virgin Mary, that he lived a perfect sinless life, that he died for our sins on the cross, that he was buried, and he rose again the third day. He's coming again. I mean, they must be Christians. That's not the problem with Catholics. They do believe all of that. But they believe some other things. You know, the Judaizers in Paul's day, they believed all of that. The Judaizers were absolutely orthodox in the gospel, except for one thing. They added to it that it is not enough to believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. You must also be circumcised and keep the law. And you know what Paul said about that? He anathematized them. He said, you add anything to the finished work of Christ upon the cross, and you are not trusting in Christ and his work on the cross. That is a false gospel. And he said anathema to anyone who preaches that. Well, the Catholic Church has had 1,500 years to add far more to the gospel than the Judaizers ever dreamed of. You ought to get the Code of Canon Law. It's about that thick. It's a huge book. And listen to this. This is the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. If anyone says that the sacraments of the new law are not essential to salvation, but that without them, through faith in Christ alone, a man can be saved, let him be anathema. You dare to say you can be saved by faith in Christ without participation in the sacraments of the Catholic Church, anathema to you. So although they believe that Christ obtained, what they say, all the graces and merits that are essential for salvation, you can't get to them. They're in a treasury. The church possesses a treasury which contains, I'm just giving you the official teaching, this is right out of Vatican II, the latest Vatican Council. The church, and this is quoting from other councils, the church possesses a treasury. And into this treasury have been deposited the merits and graces that Christ won upon the cross, to which have been added the prayers and good deeds of the Virgin Mary, to which have been added the surplus good works of the saints. They earned their own salvation with their good works, but they had a surplus, and that surplus has been put in this treasury. It is now, I'm giving you the official teaching of the Catholic Church. It is out of this treasury that the church dispenses grace. You come to Mass, we'll give you an installment. You say the rosary, we'll give you an installment. We give you another installment of grace, but you never get saved. And if you dare to say, you know that you're saved. I think I read last night a quotation from Cardinal O'Connor from St. Patrick's Cathedral. Remember what he said? Church teaching is that I do not know at any given moment what my eternal future will be. John Paul II, Pope John Paul II, does not know whether he will go to heaven, nor does Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Because you could die with mortal sin. And that's hell. That's not purgatory. There is no purgatory, but they believe in purgatory. And they keep changing things. I think you need to understand some of this to help your Catholic friends. It used to be a mortal sin to eat meat on Friday. Does anybody remember when that was? The church changed it. But it didn't help the poor souls that are in hell because they ate meat on Friday. It didn't get them out. Now, how can you trust a church that keeps changing things? And Vatican II changed indulgences. And they have very specific, look, I think I mentioned it last night, but a number of you weren't there. Let's mention it again. There are 6 holy days of obligation. Ask your Catholic friend, do you know the 6 holy days of obligation? Do you realize that it is a mortal sin not to go to Mass on one of those holy days of obligation? Now that puts you in hell. That's a mortal sin. And if you can't even remember what they are, and you don't know whether you went to Mass then or not, you are in trouble. The Catholic Church actually makes it impossible for people to get to heaven. I'm trying to be serious about this. I talk to Catholics. In the United States, we have polls. And such a high percentage, 70% of the Catholics disagree with the Pope on contraception. High percentage disagree on this or on that and so forth. Many Catholics will say, we don't even believe in indulgences. You know what Vatican II, the highest authority of the Catholic Church, says? This church teaches that the practice of indulgences is to be maintained in the church, and it condemns with anathema all those who do not accept them. Now, you can say to your Catholic friend, and I'm just trying to help you, and I think this is very solemn. You can say to your Catholic friend who doesn't believe in indulgences or doesn't agree with this or that, if you do not fear your church's anathemas, why do you believe her promises? You follow that? If you do not fear your church's anathemas, why do you believe her promises? So there are many Catholics who don't go to Mass. They realize this is phony stuff when they come to die. They want the last rites. They want a Catholic funeral. And they are still clinging to some hope that somehow this church will get them to heaven. Well, this is, I mean, I could say much more, but this is the problem with Roman Catholicism. So although they say, yes, I believe Christ died for my sins, buried, rose again, you can't get to Christ. You have to come through the church. And the church won't give it to you all at once. But you get it in installments, and you never know whether you're going to make it or not. You know, you're getting tired, and I'm going to try to wind it up as soon as I can. Let me just give you a little bit of humor to wake you up here. Catholicism, here's how it works. This dear man, he went to the priest, and he said, Father, I've tried to live a good Catholic life, but I must confess I stole some lumber. And the priest said, well, how much did you steal? You know, it depends whether it's mortal or venial. A little petty thievery, that's no problem. No, actually, it depends whether it's a mortal sin or venial sin. And how much did you steal? What did you do with it? Well, the man said, I built a doghouse. Well, the priest said, a doghouse, that's no problem. I give you absolution for that. Well, the man still had a guilty conscience, and he said, well, Father, I must confess, I did have some lumber left over. Well, how much? What did you do with it? Well, I built a garage. Whoa, now wait a minute. The priest says, this is getting serious. You built a garage. You'll have to say 25 Hail Marys and 15 Our Fathers for that. Now the priest was a little bit suspicious, and he said, now you're sure that's everything? You know, sin just goes on and on. Because there's no solution. Christ didn't finish the work. So the priest says, well, you're sure that's everything? The man said, well, Father, I did have some lumber left over. Well, how much? What'd you do with it? Well, I built a 6-bedroom house. 6-bedroom house? You'll have to make a novena for that. And the man says, make a novena? What's a novena? The priest says, you're a good Catholic. You don't know how to make a novena? I says, no, but that's okay, Father. If you got the plans, I got the lumber. Well, there's no solution. It's a problem. Promise keepers embraces Roman Catholics as Christians, and so do many leading evangelicals. But we are to trust the Lord. We're not to trust men. We're not to follow men. We're not to follow these vain delusions and these seducing spirits and false prophets. As we mentioned this morning, that's one of the problems, that they get so enamored with a person that they follow him even when he contradicts the Word of God. And you can't even show some of these people from the Scriptures. That's contrary to the Word of God. No. Benny Hinn said it. Kenneth Copeland said it. Kenneth Hagin or Rodney Howard Brown or whomever. So let's get back to the Word of God. This is our authority. Tomorrow morning I would like to look at just some amazing prophecies from Scripture that I think will encourage you in the Lord, because the Bible is so wonderful and the Lord has so much there for us, and some of us have even overlooked some of the most exciting parts of the Scripture, and we'd like to talk about that tomorrow and get off of some of this delusion. Father, what we've talked about this evening, Lord, most of it has not been edifying. It's grieving to our hearts. And yet, Lord, it's what you have foretold. You have told us that these things would happen. These are signs of the last days. These are signs of the nearness of the Lord's return. And so we lift up our heads, knowing that our salvation draweth nigh. And Father, someone has to stand up against the delusion that is overtaking the church. We've got to speak out. We've got to try to rescue others. And so, Lord, we've tried to bring some information that would be helpful in understanding what's happening, where it is taking us, and how we should respond to it. And Father, I pray that the information we've given out this evening will, as well as the verses that we've referred to from your word, will be helpful to each one here. Lord, that you will strengthen them in the faith and in the confidence that you know what is best. May we all have a sincere desire to allow you to have your way in our lives. May we say sincerely, not my will, but thine be done. Help us to trust you with every fiber of our being, with our life, with everything that we have, Lord. We put it in your hands. And then, Father, we ask that you will help us to recognize delusion and help us to stand firm, earnestly contending for the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And Lord, use us. We cry out to you for so many of these dear people who are under a powerful delusion. And Father, we want to deliver them. And so we ask that you would help us to be able to rescue many before it's too late. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.